So the real place, Central Station, is an area of South Tel Aviv that used to be quite nice, and it's the main central bus area. It was built into this gigantic, rundown monstrosity of a building that has its own nuclear fallout shelter. It's got colonies of bats living in it. It's got hidden spaces. I think it's got the biggest Yiddish library in the world hidden somewhere. And it's a very rundown, poor area that houses mostly Asian migrant workers and African refugees. And it's sort of in between Tel Aviv and Jaffa. So one is an Arab city and the other is a Jewish city. And it's this very liminal space in between. So when I was over there, I became obsessed with the station and the area around the station, you know. It's incredibly polluted because of all the buses and the trains, and I could still remember the way it used to be. And it's a really central, strange place. So my question was sort of like, what happens to the descendants of the people that you see there today? You know, what happens to those, you know, Chinese or Thai or Filipino migrants and these, you know, Sudanese refugees? And what happens to the children after that? And I thought that would be a really interesting way of writing a science fiction story that no one's ever done. I always describe this book as the best science fiction novel ever written set in Israel. But it's also, of course, the worst science fiction book set in Israel because it's the only one, pretty much. So that was that it's a real place. The idea was just to turn it into a futuristic space station a few centuries from now and write about the ordinary people who live in the shadow of that space station. Okay, so the main character of the book, or the character that introduces us to the book, because there isn't really a single main character, but what opens the book is a guy called Boris Aaron Chong, who comes from a long family from Central Station. He tries to get away from his family because the whole book is in opposition to American science fiction, you know. So I said American science fiction is full of action and adventure, and it's about a single guy and he saves the galaxy. And I said, I want to write a book where nothing exciting happens. Now, I mean, I wanted to write a book that was about family life and real life. And I wanted to write a big extended family because that's where I come from. And so this guy is the guy who tried to get away from it all. And he kind of left Earth and he went to Mars. And he thought he could get away. And his dad becomes ill and he travels back to Earth reluctantly. He doesn't want to come back. So that was the idea. And then the idea was to also explore the lives of everyone around that station, who are all connected in some way. They're all part of this big family or community. So in the book, we have a lot of different versions of human-machine hybrids. And, you know, we get robots. Because I love robots. I love humanoid robots. I love writing about humanoid robots. And one reason is they're not very practical. You know, it's kind of our science fiction idea of a robot. And an actual robot is a machine that makes cars in a factory and it doesn't look anything like it. Or I went to China and I went to an actual robotics lab in China, and they're building robots that are modeled on insects and worms. And you get this really creepy tapeworm that just can go under a door and up a wall. But they're not people robots. You know, so I love writing about people robots, I think partly because they are non-functional. So in my future history, they're already obsolete and they just hang around and they're trying to find where they belong in the world, you know. And the robotniks are, again, sort of almost like if Robocop, you know, if there are a whole bunch of Robocops that got dumped somewhere. So they're all the people who get turned into cyborgs to fight in the war, and one day is the war end and they're like, well, what do we do now? And so they're sort of like the soldiers with PTSD. So we have these two different kinds that are searching in different ways, searching for meaning, searching for what to do. While at the same time, we have the equivalent of, I guess, artificial intelligence, which is the others, which are digital consciousnesses that live in, you know, the conversation with an all-pervasive internet of everything in the solar system. And so we have different versions of these, and they're all looking for something. And, you know, there's so much discussion about artificial intelligence, and it's not actually a correct term at all. What we want to talk about is consciousness. And the thing is, we don't know anything about consciousness. We don't know about human consciousness. We don't know about animal consciousness. So we certainly can't say what a digital machine consciousness would be. So everyone who talks about artificial intelligence is missing the point. We're talking about building machines that are very good at doing something, like imitating painting or whatever. But in order to really understand them as living creatures, we have to ask, what is consciousness? What does it mean to be alive, to be thinking about yourself? So these are interesting themes to be dealing with. But, you know, again, my artificial intelligences are very alien and they don't really want much to do with the real world. They're also very much, as it would be in the real world, they're very much dependent on people keeping them alive, keeping the machines that keep them alive. So it's an interesting, you know, it's an interesting playground. And a lot of my inspiration came from both working with early internet companies and kind of understanding the basics of it. Whereas most science fiction writers don't know anything about computers, I should point out. And the other one was AI. I was very much inspired by an early professor I had who predicted pretty much everything we're seeing today. Mm-hmm.